to different places for different branches of the service, you know, and all. Bob will call me on the phone, and you know, he just blasts me. I can't understand him, what a word he says.
I'm gonna call his toll-free number when I get home.
Just call it from here and we can find out what we need.
Okay. I'll leave you and Mr. Todd together here for a little bit.
Yourself?
Okay. Yeah, I see your pen again because I fat walked off left mine. I'm sorry.
That's right.
I know the state's in pretty bad shape. We gotta have to take care of them.
Okay.
Oh, you just tell me what you need here and I'll make up something.
Okay, this is April 27th, 1988, and this is Joe Todd, and this is an interview with Mr. Victor Starkey in Guymon, Oklahoma. Sir, where were you born?
I was born in Ohio.
Ohio.
Coolville, Coolville, Ohio. Of April 1915. You just missed my birthday a couple of days.
Yep. When did you join the Army?
The 6th of January in
1941. Okay. And where'd you go for boot camp or basic?
Fort Sill.
Fort Sill. And how long did that last, your basic?
We were in Fort Sill, about 6 weeks, I guess. Mm-hmm. And then went to Camp Barkley, Texas.
What unit were you a member?
Regiment?
Yeah.
179th.
Oh, 179th and 45th Division.
45th. Company C, 179th.
So, did you join the Army or the National Guard?
Army.
Army, okay. And what did you do at Camp Barkley? What type of training did you have?
Infantry training.
Infantry?
All sorts, you know, maneuvers and such.
So, from Camp Barkley, where'd you go?
Massachusetts, Fort Evans, Massachusetts.
Mm-hmm. Is that where you went overseas?
Overseas, I went over there to Virginia. We were in
Is that Newport News?
We departed from Newport News. Yeah. And but we were in Fort Evans and then maneuvered up and down the East Coast.
We were at a pine camp? You go to Pine Camp, New York?
It's in Pine Camp, New York, yeah.
Do you know the name of the ship that you went over on?
Yeah, I just don't know.
Yeah, go ahead, take your time.
I got a little story about that. I can remember the name of the ship. That's aggravating. Leonard Wood.
The Leonard Wood?
Mm-hmm.
And tell me about the trip over. What happened?
About the tweet. At that time, that was in June of 40. 40. 3, and at that time we were the largest convoy that ever was on the ocean. And we were some 23 days getting across zigzag, amazing patrol. Never lost but one ship. Had a 2300 and something, and it got bombed in Oran, not Iran, Oran, Africa.
North Africa.
In the port.
Anything happen on the trip over? Did you get seasick or hit any storms or?
No bad storms, no. No. In fact, we didn't lose a man on the way across. We were some excitement. We, at night, we listened to the Bitch of Berlin broadcasting. Had us sunk there one night.
Who was the Bitch of Berlin? I've heard about her. What was her name?
She was a turncoat American.
Yeah.
I don't know her name.
Yeah. So, how long were you at Oran?
Oh, well, just a matter of a couple of days.
So, I guess the Germans had pretty well been beaten out of North Africa, hadn't they?
Yeah, we were there, I'll say 3-4 days. We stopped there, took some flamethrower training there. Yeah, it was over in Africa by that time.
And from Oran, where'd you go?
We went on in and invaded Sicily.
Were you in on that? Where did you go into Sicily?
I believe Scaglini.
Scaglini.
That gets a long time back, you know.
Anything happened there at Scaglini that you can recall about the invasion?
Well, the casualties were, in the invasion of Sicily, were, well, there isn't such a thing as a light casualty. If one guy's got, it's too many, but, you know, comparatively.
Light. I heard the Germans, who had air superiority there, the Americans or the Germans?
We took it pretty rapidly.
Talking about going up to, did you go to Palermo? Did you go to Palermo?
Let's see. Oh, I was there. Palermo. Can't recall. I'm getting back 40 years again now, and I'm not.
Can you recall any incidents in Sicily that happened to you?
Well, I don't know why I'm, but I'm always trying to remember. Always remember the funny things.
Tell me about
that. There were some bad things.
Yeah.
But I think that's the way man's made.
Yeah.
I remember when you got on the beach there. They just come bring our supplies and they were just dumped every which way out of those ships and all, you know. And they were then they used a bunch of several of those details to get some prisoners, took some Italian prisoners. Went and showed them the markings on our particular companies and outfits and went down and started in the back of those things. Trying to get pull our stuff, my stuff from out of your company stuff, and we just all, you know. And there's guys personal belongings and a lot of his equipment and everything. And those Italians were hungry. The Germans, they just treated them like slaves, you know. So, there was another Oboe and I. First thing we done was kick over a couple boxes of rations. Had them at it then, you know. We had buddies for life, then we've had them, got our work done. After a while, there was some colonel come strolling down through there. And me and one of those tight prisoners was sitting down there on the bank, taking turns shooting my Tommy gun. Man, he couldn't run them off, you know, with it. I got to, you might say, spoken roughly to about that.
What was the colonel's name?
Huh?
What was the colonel's name? Do you remember?
I can't remember it now.
Yeah.
Can't recall. Somebody in charge.
What was the weather like in Sicily?
If you ever have to go to war, go to Sicily.
Nice weather?
It was July there. Couldn't turn around without finding fresh stream water or something somewhere, you know, and grapes and stuff. And
how long were you on Sicily?
Hmm?
How long were you on Sicily? Any idea?
We spent the next month there. Then after the first few days in September, we invaded Italy.
Tell me about that. Where did you invade
Italy?
That's
where I got mine.
Yeah.
It was a little town by the name of Persano, but I know you're saying that it's Salerno, basically.
Tell me what happened during the invasion of Salerno. I heard it was pretty rough there in Salerno.
What?
I heard it was pretty rough in Salerno.
Yes, it was. Rough and stupid. So our intelligence was not up to par. We were supposed to go in one evening. Some of the gunmen, the Texas 36th Division, and some of the British Army were trying to bring themselves together, and there was something in between them in the middle. So this old bus go about 5 miles in. Type his contact. And we went 17 miles right straight over in there. When we come to ourselves, we was plastered surrounded. And there was 30 some odd men. Either wasn't killed or cured out of 190 in my battalion.
Get wounded there?
I never did get a scratch.
Tell me exactly what you did at Salerno. What happened? What?
Well, they had me and I first lieutenant. We could a bunch of trees on one side of the road. We came up through. If I can, but you can take his down better than telling him. then Don turned to us to come back. We came back and pulled up for a little. Guess the bus had some kind of tall or steeple or something. There was a bell there. And we came up to it. It was up on top of the rise. And we got up there. We just started walking up that embankment. And that bell started to ring. And they hit us with everything. See, they had tanks and stuff that had been buried in there for months. And just collected a bunch of us there. Run back down that hill. And one side of the road, there's a bunch of heavy trees. We could hear them coming through there. Back, I was just an open field. Me and the second one there, first lieutenant was. Pretty near said his name, but I couldn't. Laying down in that ditch, and I had a 45, and he had all the little carbines. There come those Tiger tanks down that road. He said, "What do you think we ought to do, Starkey?" I says, "Lieutenant, if you want to slide down and take a shot at that tank with that carbine, I'm going to slide down and take right away with my 45. I says, "What do you think?" I was mad for that time. He asked me what to do. He says, "I guess we better just stand up." I said, "It might be a good idea." So they took us there.
What was your reaction when, at that point?
Like I'm telling it to somebody else right now. I wasn't even like watching it in a movie. It's not real until later.
Do you remember the date?
11th of September.
1943. And how did they treat you when you were first captured?
I really got no... I have no kick coming there. I saw some people mistreated later, but... generally, there was no kick coming.
And where did they take you from there, Salerno?
Right up through the Brenner Pass, in the Alps, in the Austrian, Germany's where I went.
And how did you travel?
Boxcar.
Boxcar?
40 and 8. Do you remember the old World War thing? 40 by 8.
8 horses and 40 men?
8 horses.
How many men were in each boxcar?
I couldn't recall.
Were pretty crowded? Or?
Yeah, it was pretty crowded. And they had a bunch of us.
How did they treat you at this time? You know, on the train.
I can't say they treated us bad.
What about the food and water, did they?
Well, it was... wasn't much. But a lot of times I will say the fact that we had as much as they did. And,
when you went into Austria and Germany, what was the reaction of the civilians to the Americans?
Well, we get some bad reviews, you might say, but ordinarily they treat us pretty good. Individual is an individual with these black, white, German, Japanese. And that's the thing that I've always said is the world soldier is the same the world over. You don't know who, what, when, or why. All they want us to do is get out and go home.
Where did they take you in Germany? rest for a while?
We were within about 90 miles of where we had. Stall Lake 2B.
Stall Lake 2B.
Hammerstein. That's got it to Hammerstein. And from then, we were taken out on different patrols, working parties, farms.
What kind of work do you have to do with the farm?
Well, field work.
Field work.
Shovel manure, just anything, you know.
How did the guards at Stalag 2B treat you?
I would say that 9 out of 10 or more were all right. Most of them had been on the Russian front and wounded and was back.
What was their, how did they treat the Americans, or how was their reaction to you, the Germans?
Well, they were a little bit in dread of us. They thought we was all crazy.
Why'd they think you were crazy?
Because we carried on. Drum outlaw old sergeant one time. Of course, at that time he must have been an old World War I veteran because he was an old man. And he said, "I can handle 1,000 Polacks. 10,000 whatever Frenchmen." He said, "You got 50 Americans, you're driving me crazy." We paid ignorance on, you know. But with a piece of machinery or something, we tell them, we got all that automatic at home. We don't know how to do this. And, you know, just
what type of barracks did you have at Stalag 2B?
Just more or less, they weren't built as barracks and stuff. Well, they were in the camps, but it was like, you know, the old heroes, or as the construction, the looks of the buildings, it was, we didn't have all the stuff, but a lot of that was based on truth.
What type of food did they give you?
Well, potatoes was the main thing. And that was, had been in Red Cross parcels for it. It probably would have been pretty rough at times.
When you went to work on the farms, did you have any contact with the German farmers?
Yeah, they would put, two of them in charge of 7 or 8 of us.
What was their reaction to the Americans?
Mainly all right. Just curiosity. And then we just saw some bad ones, didn't we?
How often did you have a roll call?
They had a roll call every morning or in the night if we were out in the fields or very wide. Rather come in.
I was going to ask, would you describe your average day in the prison camp? You know, when you got up, the meals you had, the work details, and then when you went to bed?
Well, I don't know what we was doing, whether it was working in the working out in the field, they'd take the manure out there, maybe not spread that, possibly, or cut the maize and stuff. then in the thresher, we in the field, in the grain like we do, they take it and put it in the barn. Then in inclement weather, why they would do that work then.
Yeah. What time do they get you up every morning?
Depending on some of the seasons of the year. About, you know, for daylight and dark and stuff. In the winter it was pretty short hours because it wasn't much daylight. Other times it'd be long hours like it's getting now, you know, in older hours of the day.
You still have your uniform?
That's a deal that
yeah.
1944 that the paper
yeah.
put out of me.
What did you wear in the prison camp?
Huh?
What did you wear in the prison camp?
The Red Cross sent us uniforms, just anything that any American, probably outsizes and mistakes and stuff. Best we could with it.
Did you ever take a bath or a shower?
Well, they had this place there, in this particular place I was, in a boiler room there. Or we could go once a week and get a bath. Right at the last there. I probably got a pretty good record. I got from the February 19th, at least the 19th, and probably before that, but at least the 19th of February until the third day of May without a bath. Record, but it's a fair average.
Who was the highest ranking prisoner in the camp? Did you have a chain of command among the prisoners?
If you had any rank, you were in another camp. Before your rank would be just a BFC would be their coach. As far as the prisoner was concerned. If they were non-commissioned officers, right, they didn't have to work there, but in another camp.
Did you have any news of how the war was progressing?
Yeah, we had very good news.
How'd you get the news?
BBC. The Germans would tell us. They weren't supposed to, but they would tell us.
So the Germans told you how the war was going?
Yeah. They all knew that it was a matter of time, you know.
Did they tell you about D-Day? Or June 6, 44?
Yeah. Yeah, they told us that. Just a little. Puddled up here. They came down and told us that morning that the Allies had invaded.
And you say they weren't supposed to tell you, the Germans?
Huh?
They weren't supposed to tell you, give you word of the...
Oh, well, I mean, no, that just goes without reason. I mean, they wouldn't be supposed to.
Yeah. Did the treatment... Did the attitude of the guards toward you change as the war progressed? You know, when it was evident that they were going to lose, did their treatment toward you change?
Well, even from the day I got there, I mean, they knew then that it was, you know,
Most of them were pretty very sort of guy. We had one guy that was a tailor. He didn't know where his family was or anything. And he'd take these clothes, and we got some of his Red Cross stuff, we got some powdered milk and stuff in, you know. We get these Red Cross parcels. We'd give him stuff like that. He'd sew for us. And he was good.
Was he a German?
And so he was saving a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
We gave him so when the war's over here, he went up for his family. He did fine. Yeah. Oh, there's tragic things on both sides. There's no getting around.
What's your worst memory of prison?
Early in February, 45, that's, they brought a bunch of, we were close enough up here, but we could watch them bomb Danzig, we could see the fires. And they brought about 400 refugees, men, women, children. So you're there one night and kept them overnight. Shot four of them the next morning because they couldn't get up and go. Seems impossible to human being, you know. Like I say, the German people mainly weren't that way. It was the maniacs, you know, their SS troopers.
What kind of refugees were they?
Huh?
What type of refugees were they?
Jews and.
Oh, from the concentration camps. And then what's your, if I can ask, the fondest memory of prison camp that sounds strange?
You know, well, a lot of times the guy wouldn't believe that. But there was times when we had a law. You never, it's hard to picture. But human beings gonna find something someplace. If he didn't, you'd kill him, I guess. But we tease them unmercifully. And they don't catch on too good, you know. And we tell them based on that. Lies and never sneak a stick yet. We was having to pick potatoes a hand, they had a machete going on. A little wheel of whirling behind it, kicked these potatoes out of the ground. We had to gather them up. I told one of them one day, I says, right at home we got one. We have, just take some out of the ground and sack them. And we did, but I didn't know that.
You doing okay?
Huh?
You okay?
Yeah. Just have to.
When did you know, were you aware of VE Day at the warhead ended?
Huh?
Were you aware of VE Day, you know, when Germany surrendered?
Along in February, that's where I said that February the 19th on that BAM, because I think that's when they pulled us out of the camp. We all put us on the road, and we were on the road for a while. They didn't know what to do with us. Found out later that Hitler had put out orders to kill all the prisoners, but some of that sense stuff about that. About to do that, of course.
they take you?
All over.
They traveled over 800 miles over Germany and around.
What'd you eat while you're on the road?
Whatever we had, we'd get. I'd step with some of these farmers. We'd steal stuff. We got strafed twice by the English. They thought we was German troops, killed a bunch of us.
How did the guards treat you at this point when you were marching up the road?
They weren't any better off than we are. But where I was much.
You go out and start digging all these potato mounds where they hadn't buried for the winter, you know, we dig into them.
They'd tell us to stop and they'd shoot and tell them to go lay out.
When did you see your first American?
Well, we had, let me back up a little bit now. In fact, we had been strafed two or times. Well, the last time, about this time right now, we told them we weren't marching anymore because we had been shot at twice, and they had gotten wood down through the International Red Cross for us not to do anything. To try anything because it was getting so close. So we said we weren't going to march and get out on the road anymore. And we didn't. And they didn't make us. So there had been a German guard with us that had been a prisoner of war during World War I over here in the Navy, in the German Navy. We talked quite a bit. And he said, how he'd like to be here. Morning of the 3rd of May, he showed up without his rifle. He says, where's your gun? And I said, I'm not crazy. He said, your troops will be here about 1 o'clock. He said, I listened to BBC last night. He dismissed it an hour. 2 o'clock here. Some of happened to 7th Army Camp.
What was your reaction?
And it was quite a deal, man. Anyway, nobody touched those guards or hurt them or anything. I mean, it was just like the last I saw this particular guy. One of our tankers had him down in a tank. He was asking about the tank. People are people.
So where did they take you after you were released?
Camp Lucky Strike. That's France. We stayed in France about months ago, because it was 8th of June when we got here. Yeah. Italy shot Germany for just a few days there. Town, I suppose, about 50,000 been blown from there off the map. And then an attack. Support in France. Okay.
he sent home by plane or boat?
Boat.
Boat.
Yeah.
Do you know which boat you came home on?
Yeah, they had it.
I don't remember what it was. It was attached. Italian ship. I don't remember the name of it though.
Where did you land in the States?
Huh?
Where did you land in the States?
At, it's a terrible guy. I can't remember things like that.
Did you come to New York?
Into the Statue of Liberty.
I was going to ask, when you saw the Statue of Liberty, what was your reaction?
Well, we had no good things about the ship, but of course she was the girl of the day. She went to New Jersey. We came into New Jersey, I guess it was New Jersey. June '45.
And when were you discharged?
18th of August.
'45. I was going to back up. When you were in Italy being taken over Brenner Pass in that area, what was the reaction of the Italian people to the Americans?
They really thought we were the heroes, because they gave no resistance at all. Well, they ran past, they didn't see anything there. We were just in those cars there, through that pass.
Had Italy surrendered at this time? You know, they surrendered and then...
Yeah, I think they see. No, they hadn't surrendered at the time we hit Sicily. Because there's a few of them shot. I think they killed our captain there.
Yeah.
Their main idea was to fire a few shots for the honor of the thing. And then
did you go through Rome?
Yeah, just barely around, I remember.
Do you be able to reflect back on your time as a prisoner?
Huh?
What do you think about today when you think about your time as a prisoner?
What do you mean?
I mean, what do you think about, do you ever reflect back on it? You know, how you were treated, just...
Well, I get to thinking, it is rough, but I'm hearing a lot of them. You know,
whenever you hear the word Stalag, what do you think of?
Yeah, that's always that always mean confinement.
What does the word Stalag mean?
Yeah, I don't know whether literally whether it's translated as a prison or. But they called all those camps Stalags, you know.
Yeah. Well, anything else you want to talk about the prison camp? And we're finishing up now.
You made it.
Did you find out anything?
I'm going to call when I get home. The line was busy. Okay?
Yeah.
And I won't. You and Bob will both have a call, question forms you're asking for, and I'll get back with you and we'll fill them out, okay?
Yeah.
All that letter says they'll send a form in here to question for you.
I know I'm leaving out stuff here, but
okay.
Yeah, I'm just kind of...
See, that wasn't too bad, was it? Nothing to get nervous about?
No, I just...
Didn't you know the camera's there, did you?
Didn't pay attention to it. Well, we get to see the preview.
Well, you can see it right now if you want.
Just hang her on.
Okay, thank you.
Jim, I want you to see that.